Vice had an editorial called, this is the title, SNL cold opens are unfunny elitist pieces of liberal propaganda. And so on this week's episode of SNL, we had one of those unfunny elitist pieces of liberal propaganda, which was it this week or was it last week where they had Stormy Daniels? But they had the Donald.
I think it was three. Oh no, 2 weeks ago was Stormy Daniels. 3 weeks ago was the Meet the Parents or something.
There you go. So look, they have versions of various people in the White House. You know, Kate McKinnon will show up as the Attorney General and all that stuff. The Vice writer was not having it in any way. There were references to limousine liberals, and the word elitist was used quite a bit. Now, obviously, I think it probably goes without saying that these SNL cold opens are popular. I think it's one of the reasons they become as common as they are, is that the people who watch SNL do like it. The writer did make the point, or actually, I think Rob Schneider was quoted in the piece saying, it was nice back in the day that you didn't know for sure which way SNL was gonna go. You had a general idea that it was left-leaning, that it would go in a liberal direction, but you didn't know for sure. But now you can expect that the comedy will be meant to appeal to liberals. What do you think about those criticisms, which
first,
vary in intensity?
I would like to say there was a part of the show where you said Vice doesn't like it. Now,
I'll say this writer on
Vice.
Right,
this writer on Vice. And that's the thing that a lot of people say, like, well, the New York Times is running an editorial. It's like, well, that's different than saying they're publishing an op-ed.
You are 100% right.
Still, they both, like, both cases, the editorial board is sanctioning the running of this, and you need to factor that into decision making. That's it. I represent a contingent of people. Masnilga. This is my Masnilga hat. Much like Make America Great Again, invoke some kind of nostalgia for a better time when America was perfect. For generations, there have been Masnilgers out there who think that SNL used to be amazing every single minute of every single episode. And unfortunately, that's wrong. No matter how much you're tempted to say, it was the Dana Carvey and Mike Myers episodes that were amazing the whole way through.
No, it was the Will Ferrell episode.
When you say that, oh my God. At the time Will Ferrell was on, there were people like me saying, let's go back to the Halcyon days.
No, it was Tim Meadows.
Oh, remember that one year where they burned everyone alive and they just kept Lovitz over. The next year was run by whoever and Billy Crystal was on it. That was perfect.
I liked Horatio Sands. Once they got rid of him, I feel like they lost a lot of their absurdity.
Exactly. Oh, the Giggle Times with Jimmy Fallon, those were the best.
No.
But that's the problem. Now, that said, I do think there is no denying that SNL has a liberal bent, always has. There is also no denying what Schneider is saying, which is, listen, they pick fights with both sides. Their jokes against, in the debate era, there would be jokes against George H.W. Bush and against Michael Dukakis. Both of them.
They certainly made fun of Bill Clinton a lot.
But they made fun of Bill Clinton. You're absolutely right.
They had a Barack
right.
Obama.
Now,
or more than one Barack Obama.
As Hillary's running, there's a lot of female writers and performers who came on and were like, let's just make this happen. The polar comes back. They have a bunch of people who are like, come on. Now, the kernel of truth I will find within the Vice article is that the comedian should only be concerned with truth and not be concerned with any kind of agenda. Once you become concerned with your agenda, then you sacrifice some of your funny. And sometimes you have to do that in order to make a point because that's important. And it's easier to do that as a liberal because when you're a liberal, you're typically punching up. And when you're being a conservative, you're typically punching down. Yeah. So you have more cushion if you're going more agenda-driven on a piece. And the satire is more in your favor. But what do you think?
Let's talk about that. So in these cold opens of the sort that this particular writer was talking about, it's generally the sort where it's, you've got your fake Trump, you've got your fake, you know, maybe Michael Cohen shows up, and then there's Stormy Daniels and the Attorney General. And so I guess to the extent that they are talking about what is topical, because generally these skits are, here are the five things that have happened in the news having to do with these people, we're gonna make references to them. Stormy Daniels is gonna show up.
Right.
There's gonna be something about him being spanked up with the Forbes or something like that. I guess they're true to the extent that they're talking about real things. They're not talking about things that are not already being discussed, which is certainly the case. I don't understand what the criticism is. To say that it's unfunny seems wrong. obviously some people think it's funny. You can say that it's unfunny, but saying it's elitist versus unfunny, I don't know why liberal comedy is always elitist. First of all, it's making fun of the people with all the political power
right. In
this country right now. So it's a little bit odd to pitch it as elitist. I also don't understand why liberal comedy is always elitist. And also, again, and this is something that we return to a lot, it's always, the onus is always on liberals to reach out, to be the understanding ones, to never have a place that is for themselves or whatever, to never be, like, we're supposed to at the same time celebrate Roseanne, which turned out to not be nearly as political as we thought that it would be, and condemn SNL for appealing to people who are frustrated with Donald Trump.
I mean, this SNL thing is just someone who falsely believes that every SNL cold open is hilarious, is thought to be hilarious by everyone. Mm-hmm. We already made it easy for you, Vice writer. At the end of the day, they then put the funny ones online. You get to watch it in a condensed mm-hmm. format. Mm-hmm. I don't know. I don't really fully understand what you mean by, like, we have to reach out to everyone.
I think that I'm not just talking about in terms of comedy, but I'm saying that I believe that in the way that there are always going to be New York Times think pieces where they go and they interview white supremacists or Trump voters, like, I don't believe that there's a lot of, I don't know, red state or whatever, where they're like, we embedded ourselves with some hippies in San Bernardino.
Right.
We're gonna talk to them about, like, that seems to be very much be a thing that both only the liberals would do, and they're the ones being requested to do it.
So for these cold opens, you have to make a choice. The idea of that we're just rehashing the things that are in the news, or that, you know, SNL's rehashing what's in the news. Listen, the SNL people are working with what you know. Otherwise, they have to teach, as a comedy writer, we have mm-hmm. to teach you what the fact is, do the setup, and then do the joke to laugh about. And you can get that from John Oliver, where he's like, here's a bunch of facts in a row, mm-hmm. now here's a joke about it. But the SNL cold open, you have to work with the general knowledge that everybody has.
To fit in as
I will say that there is some laziness in what you see through Alec Baldwin every so often, mm-hmm. but you can't expect it to be, you know, amazing every single time. They compare it to the sketch shows that have come and gone. Well, those sketch shows don't have to do an hour and a half with a host who just kind of shows up
and reads off cue cards.
It's a half hour of stuff that they've had in the hopper, and they only have to do a few weeks in a row, and then they have weeks off.
Yeah, that's true.